So more data than the entire global internet traffic of today will be collected by the Square Kilometre Array.
Yeah.
So all the cat videos on the internet, if you combine those together, in fact, we're going to have more data than that, even more.
I can't think of any more human activity than conducting science experiments.
The game I play is a very interesting one. It's imagination in a tight straitjacket.
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together.
What I always think should be the basis of education is not answers, but questions. We should teach kids how to question.
Today on the podcast, we have Lisa Harvey-Smith, who is an astronomer, science communicator. You've been a host on Stargazing. And recently, you've released a book called When Galaxies Collide.
I have, yeah. It's awesome. I've even got it here. I'm going to wave it.
Beautiful, yeah.
Awesome. Ooh, it's pretty.
So, we'll put some links to that.
Yeah, it's so cool. Where you can purchase it, yeah.
We thought we'd kick it off. Look, usually when we get people on the episode, we're talking about what got them passionate about science, but we noticed that one of your other passions is sport. So we're both quite passionate about sport. I play ice hockey, and I love watching sport and soccer and things as well. And Hamid is also pretty into sport.
Yeah, well, I think that sport is a way of understanding yourself. Like, you get a glimpse of your true character.
Oh yeah, definitely, definitely. Yeah, I mean, I've always loved sport. I did judo as a kid, did it for 9 years, got to national level. Whoa. And started coaching. And it's just great to get that energy out of you. You know, it's a natural thing. I was always running around, cycling and climbing trees and stuff, but you know, got seriously into sports and athletics, and I actually thought I would be an athlete professionally. I never kind of felt I was going to be anything else, but
that's awesome.
You know, I love running now. Like, I do ultra marathons now. Yeah. That's a real test, because you run for 6 days through the desert.
Yeah, I find sports incredibly relaxing when I'm playing sport. I don't think about anything else except the sport. It's such an intense focus that you lose all of that stuff that's just in the back of your head.
Yeah, I think it's for those of us who either we need to meditate or do sports, or some people take drugs, which is probably a bad way to do it. But, you know, it's that kind of thing where you get out of your head and you get everything into your heart and your body, and that's the focus. It's really cool.
Yeah. Well, ultra marathons is that takes a special kind of person to be willing to go through that sort of adversity.
Yeah, it's a privilege for someone who doesn't have any real adversity in their life, that you can actually just, you know, suffer and choose to stop suffering when you finish. But, you know, doing marathons and doing ultra marathons, which is anything longer than a marathon, has always been, you know, in the last 10 years, something that I can test myself with.
Yeah.
So I've done, you know, 4 marathons in a day. I've done 6-day races. I've done desert races, all sorts of stuff. And it's just great because there's camaraderie between the participants. There's you know, that test of your soul and how much you want it.
So
all that kind of
forgive
stuff.
My ignorance, 4 marathons in a day, that's a marathon's 42.2.
Oh, so I did 168 more, a bit more.
So that's
K's
the 100 mile marathon.
Yeah, 100 miles. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, that was painful. That was really painful. Tell you what, I don't know
I'm
what
in pain
I was
just thinking about it.
Oh,
yeah.
It was horrible.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it was great, and it's one of the sort of proudest things I've achieved in the, you know, sporting arena. And I think looking back, that day was hard, but you know, you get that pride afterwards, so it's cool.
Hamid's dying to ask you about judo, because when we were discussing this, we were he was like, "Oh, Lisa's done judo, man." And I'm like, I've read something, or maybe it was just in your high school days or something. In your youth, but to hear that you're going on, because Hamid's right into Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. So
cool, yeah.
Yeah, so I've been doing that for like 6 years. I coach people as well.
Awesome.
But judo is a much harder sport than Jiu-Jitsu because you're just getting tossed on your head, yeah, get on your back, and
you're
that's
getting thrown around. It's called the gentle way. That's nonsense. I tell you what, that's rubbish.
Is that the translation? Is it?
Yeah, it's called the gentle way.
That's the original fake
it's not
news.
when I broke someone's collarbone accidentally, that was not gentle. I did not mean to do that, but it's not always gentle.
Yeah, and it's so cool because you lose leverage and technique. And you can really tackle on bigger people, stronger people, and it works.
It's amazing. We used to do demos of judo, and we would get, I'd be the tiniest kid, and I'd be throwing the biggest guy and, on the floor on his back. And it was really cool.
Yeah, that's awesome.
That's a great way to do things.
I find that, like, martial arts in particular, it's like high-level problem-solving with dire consequences.
Yeah, it's physics, I guess, if you like to look at it that way, in its purest form. But, yeah, if it goes wrong, you're on your head.
Yeah.
Your leg snaps or something. It's not good. But, you know, most of the time it goes well. And I love the discipline of martial arts. I like the respect that people pay to one another and to their coaches. You know, you bow or you do ceremonies, I guess. So it's a kind of a nice cultural thing. But also you get your aggression out, whether you're boxing, whether you're doing martial arts or other types of fighting. It's a really good way to get that aggro out.
Yeah, I can totally relate to that. Just do you find like there's any parallels? Do you draw like I find that like doing martial arts has impacted. You mentioned discipline, but just the ability to tackle challenges, for instance, like that you have way more self belief that you can solve it.
Yeah,
and confidence. I think that comes so in handy when you're doing research when things aren't going well.
I think so. Problem solving, or for example, if you're however many points down and someone just has to trip you over one more time on your side and you're going to be out of the bout. You can come back, and any sport teaches you that. Whether you're 40 love down in tennis or if you're playing a sport where you're just about to get tripped over and you're out of the competition. But you can get it back always in sport. And it's that belief that miracles happen sometimes. you can make those miracles happen. They don't happen on their own. But I like that. And research can be a slog as well. It really can. But it's got rewards. It's fantastic. When you discover something no one's ever seen before, ever.
Yeah. Yeah.
No human being has ever discovered. You know what it's like. Yeah. It's amazing. It's cool. Yeah. It's really cool.
Puts a tingle down your spine.
Yeah.
Great. Maybe we can move on because we were talking before that you've actually had quite an unorthodox kind of upbringing, I was reading that. Is it both your parents were teachers or just your mum?
Yeah, my mum was a head teacher in a primary school, and my parents met at teacher training college, but my dad didn't ever become a professional teacher.
Okay, yeah.
So they were kind of both into that. But my mum was a head teacher, and I went to the primary school where she taught. And then when I became 11, when I finished the primary school, they offered me the opportunity to learn at home and not go to school at all.
Yeah.
And I took that. I thought that was cool because I could get more freedom. I could do what I wanted.
Yeah.
That kind of person. So I relished that freedom. It was really good.
Yeah.
As we were saying before, our parents, I could never imagine them giving us that choice. Why do you think your parents did?
I think my dad read a lot of books by philosophers and teachers of kind of unorthodox ways of education as well. And I think they would have, if there was a really good school where kids were allowed to kind of grow in their own way, we probably would have gone to one of those. But, you know, we didn't have any money to go to a fancy school or anything. So that was the opportunity to have an unorthodox education and to follow our dreams, however corny that sounds, to actually just do stuff that we like doing. I did sport like 6 hours a day.
Wow.
I played the violin, I played music, guitar. I looked at, subjects that weren't available at school, like astronomy. And that's my job now. So, it really worked for me. That's cool.
Were there any limitations
So you mentioned some things like having access to astronomy, but did you have like did the education system limit opportunities
Well, you said you wanted to get into astronomy, so
was that, why was that maybe not part, why was that maybe a limitation if you'd gone through formal education?
Well, I didn't know at the time. When I was 11, I'd never even done astronomy, but I found it by learning at home because I had that freedom. And I guess the school curriculum was quite restrictive. And even at that time, 1991, when I left school, girls and boys were separated in the subjects that they had to do. So boys got to do cool things like woodwork and metalwork.
So it wasn't a free choice. Like,
yeah, and girls were stuck doing rubbish stuff and didn't do as much science and so on. It's terrible, but it's true. So, you know, I just didn't have that kind of feeling that I wanted to be part of this crappy system, to be honest. I wanted to break free from it and do what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
And who wouldn't?
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because we've had a researcher who looked at the gender disparity in STEM, and she was talking about how we have these social paradigm or social views on what men and women can do, these stereotypes that are very limiting, and particularly women in STEM, that's a big issue that exists, particularly in our postgrad. So it's an open shared space, and you look at the hard scientists like the chemists and the biologists, and it's like literally like two women, I think.
There's a few problems there, and it stems from the way that girls and boys are treated differently and given different expectations and boundaries, I think, when they're young. And then when women do get into STEM subjects, and you know, women are graduating in science at equal levels to men in many subjects, in many scientific and technical subjects, not all, but in many, but then they actually don't progress through their careers at the same rate because of various factors which are conspiring against them. And a number of those are just structural, because we've built our society as a male-dominated society over the last 200, 300 more years, and that has been broken down very slowly, but it hasn't been fully dismantled. So you know, there's still factors that are affecting women, and the rates of hiring, the rates of the first salaries are not the same, and it's just not working the way we're doing things. So we've got to try and break that down. So I've done a lot of work on this through the Astronomical Society of Australia. I was the head of the Women in Astronomy chapter for that, and we set up whole national schemes to try and make workplaces fairer to everyone and to make men and women access things equally, including parental leave, try and get guys and dads to access parental leave, for example, which helps if they're with a female partner.
Right.
And it's, you know, it's really, it's about getting equality for men as well as equality for women, because men often feel constrained from, you know, child rearing and things like that, because they're expected to do certain things.
It's fascinating, because Alex and I have, like, I think the benefit of working in the same research group, we have our tables are right next to each other, so we get into these long discussions about a capitalistic society, because money drives. There's a good book that I read called Sapiens, and it was making just a brief history of Homo sapiens and how we came to be who we are now. And you're saying that science is driven by capitalism. And capitalism, capitalism works on growing and getting more and more money. And so you have a system that's designed that doesn't take into account the well-being of humans, and that involves women, allowing them to have maternity where they can raise children, parents as well. So the focus is on the money rather than the human aspect of the whole structure. And that leads to just cutting out 50% of the population, because they have a biological clock that's working against them. And so they have to prioritize one or the other. And rather than building a system where you can facilitate both those things, we're still stuck in this old school.
Achieve as fast as you can and as much as you can.
And gather as many resources for yourself and your family at the expense of others, perhaps. There's so many sociological factors, and I think that's probably one of them that contributes.
What can we do about this as science communicators? Like, obviously, I think a big part of that is encouraging more women role models in science.
Yeah, this is important. When you look on the internet and you look for public-facing scientists, I guess you will see, and you look in bookshops too, and you look for shows and TV shows and that kind of thing, you'll just see so many more male faces than female. You know, I'm trying to break this down. I'm writing books and doing a tour this year. You know, like Brian Cox does a tour, I'm doing a tour. And you know, I want to tour Australia and show Australians that women are doing great science and we are great communicators. And, you know, but it's not just about that. You've got to break these structural things that are actually impeding progress as well. And that's going to be a long task, but you know, one person at a time. If each person can do something, especially men as allies, to try and facilitate the changes that are required, then that's really, really very, very important.
And I think that's how you really do make the change, to recruit everyone to actually redesign the system. I mean, I have little nieces and I teach them Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. So people have like, they're just like, you don't give them direct instruction, but you know, you just make it like a little game with them and they can pick up stuff. And it's really cool because I suppose in my culture, Afghanistan, women have specific roles and they can only act in a certain way, behave in a certain way. Doing like grappling is very frowned upon, and that's a man.
You have to forget he's a bit sick today.
Sorry.
Yeah, that's
all right. I had my sister's wedding last night, so I partied hard while I was It doesn't help.
Sorry, I interrupted.
But yeah. So yeah, like, I think people should, when they consider their own family members in the next generation, then it becomes very obvious how important it is to design a fair system so that their nephews and their children can be and do whatever they want to do, and they don't have to fight against the whole system in order to be an astronomer or an astrophysicist or a science communicator.
Yeah, it's about expectations, and if girls have equal expectations to boys, they will achieve equal things. And if they're discouraged, and I constantly see people discouraging their girls from going forward, unfortunately, that can be problematic. So we've just got to watch for how we react to aspirations in the genders and what we expect people to achieve, and keep tempering that.
Perhaps we can shift gears a little bit and talk a little bit about science communication.
Yeah.
Obviously, that's something both Hamid and I are really passionate about. And I thought I'd just start with a funny story. We actually had Dr. Carl on the podcast, and we asked him, what can scientists do to be better science communicators, right? Because, you know...
Make a smile, I'd say.
Yeah, yeah. But his answer might surprise you. His answer was they shouldn't be science communicators. His answer was that, and we didn't have very long with him. I would have liked to interrogate him a little bit more on that point, because I actually really disagree.
Yeah.
And perhaps he didn't mean it literally. And
what I gathered from him was he was saying that scientists have enough on their plate, where you have to go through so much training to become a scientist.
Specialist training.
And now to become a science communicator and to expect that from your local scientist, that's a different, and it's...
It's unreasonable to expect scientists to be good science communicators, because they're a different skill set and they're not trained in it. I'm like,
I think some,
screw that.
No, I think you're going to get some scientists who will always be hopeless at communicating, and you'll get some scientists who are really good at it. And it's about just allowing those who want to do it and are good at it to flourish, really, giving them the platform, the opportunity, and lessening the impact on their careers. Because that's like you were saying about capitalism and growing and being greedy. Science works that way in career growth as well. So scientists, researchers are often encouraged to just publish their work in papers at the expense of pretty much everything else. All the incentives are linked to the number of things you publish. And even in my job, you know, science communication is given, it's right down at the bottom. It's you're not incentivized to do it at all. So you know, it's a difficult thing, because you know it's important and you know you're passionate about it, and it's incredibly useful, not only to educate people, inspire people to become scientists and understand science and its role in society, but also to get the next generation of scientists coming through. So really, we're doing everyone a favor, science communicators, but we're not necessarily getting the rewards. We want to carry on doing research.
That is interesting that we have this publish or perish paradigm in science, and there isn't a heavy focus on science communication. And I just find that really interesting, because scientists are always complaining about the misrepresentations of science in the media and how society perceives science as, you know, sometimes...
That's a real problem, right?
Yeah, that's it.
It's arrogant, basically.
Yeah, arrogant, they think they know it all, and like... But it's interesting that on our part, the system is structured in such a way that they're reluctant to even address that issue by keeping that into consideration and adding more value to the fact that this person is educating the public or communicating science.
Yeah, it's an interesting sociological phenomenon, I think, where science communicators can be looked down on, I think, by people who don't do that communication. Mm. But you know what? You just carry on because you guys know you're doing a great service here. You're doing podcasts and people are benefiting and people are learning and getting a bigger picture view on what science really is. So that's important. And what you do is important. That's why you do it. Mm. You know, in society, we all have different roles and we all have different skill sets. And let's just accept that not every scientist is going to be good at it or want to do communication.
So why... Yeah, that's a nice segue. So why do you want to do science communication? Why do you like it?
I just love talking to people and getting that reaction back. Last night I gave a talk at the Sydney Science Festival at the Powerhouse Museum to 300 people. And there's loads of kids in the audience and there are loads of adults in the audience. And I show a slide and I describe something amazing happening in the universe when our galaxy in 3.8 billion years is going to collide with the Andromeda Galaxy. And I show a movie of this and people gasp, people actually gasp. And I hear this noise and that makes me just smile inside and outside. And it's the best feeling when the kids afterwards came up to get me to sign their book and have a selfie. And these 4, 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old kids just so excited because I've shown them something they haven't seen before, the universe in a way that they haven't considered.
Yeah.
What I like about science communication is that the discovery that, you know, the feeling that you get when you discover, like that euphoria and that those sensations, you can pass it on to someone else by sharing that piece of knowledge and seeing them go through the, oh my God, that is so cool.
It's like teaching. We've both done quite a bit of teaching and it's a similar thing. Like having your students achieve is far better than any achievement that I've done. Like you get a way bigger buzz out of it.
It must be like a parental feeling, really. Yeah, you're proud of someone else's learning or growth or that kind of thing. Yeah. You know, that's how I feel with the reaction you get to something amazing.
Yeah. We should talk a little bit about your book.
It's a good segue. She did talk about
when galaxies
colliding. So.
Yeah.
So you mentioned the Andromeda Galaxy colliding with our galaxy.
It's really going to happen. It's really going to happen.
And How long have we got?
We've got 3.8 billion years till it starts. My God, though. Seriously, we live in a fantastic region of the universe with 50 galaxies all kind of melding together and spiraling around each other because gravity is keeping them in this big clump. Yeah. And the biggest galaxy near us is Andromeda Galaxy. It's a big spiral, just like the Milky Way, and it has a mass quite a bit bigger than the Milky Way, we think, although they might have a bit less dark matter, so we're not quite sure. But anyway, the gravity between the galaxies is pulling us together at 400,000 kilometers per hour.
Yeah.
That's remarkable speed. So in every hour, the Andromeda Galaxy gets closer to us by a distance equal to 10 times the circumference of the Earth.
Wow,
every hour.
Yeah.
So in 1 billion years, it will be huge in the sky. We'll see this like huge, bigger than the full moon, brighter. Wow. It will be incredible.
Yeah,
and
that's
in
amazing.
5 billion years, we will have kind of melded together with the Andromeda Galaxy. Yeah. So all the stars will kind of be merging together. There'll be half a trillion stars in our night sky. Whoa. The Earth may have well been flung out by gravity of the galaxy completely, and we could be hurtling out into intergalactic space with no stars around us, so that the sky could be completely black after that.
Because a lot of people, when they imagine galaxies colliding, are probably thinking about stars hitting each other.
Yeah,
but
no.
It's not really like that, is it?
That's it. If you see the gaps between stars, they are huge.
Yeah.
And stars themselves are tiny compared to these gaps. So when the galaxies collide, they kind of move through each other like a pair of ghosts.
Yeah.
Casper the Friendly Ghost. But there's other stuff. There's not just stars. There's gas as well.
Yeah.
So the gas actually collides. So that's the stuff that collides. And the gas in the spiral arms of our galaxy will collide, and it will spark the production of millions of new stars.
Yeah.
And they will just pop, pop, pop across the sky. There'll be so much light in the sky. There'll be spiral arms kind of dragged across by gravity, encasing the Earth like beautiful hug by a cosmic octopus of these beautiful spiral arms, and then these new stars will start exploding as supernovae after they've finished burning.
Wow,
so
yeah.
The future of our night sky is incredible.
Yeah.
If only we were around to witness it.
If only. Well, yeah. We'll be dead by then. But,
yeah.
You know, if we can go to other stars and other planets and live there, perhaps we can survive.
Yeah.
Perhaps.
It'd be ironic if that planet gets hit.
Yeah.
Collision.
Option C, live on spaceships.
Yep, live on spaceships. Absolutely. I mean, if we can learn to somehow mine all of our raw materials from intergalactic space, then yeah. That could happen too.
I could imagine a big rocket propeller stuck to the Earth and just...
So we need to start investing in space agencies right now.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
So will the Earth be around, or would our star have exploded, engulfed it?
Yeah, in about a billion years, the sun will have increased its brightness and its temperature so much that all the water on the Earth will have evaporated.
Mm.
So there'll be no oceans, no rivers, no lakes, no seas, nothing. There'll just be, all the water will have boiled off.
Mm.
So the Earth will be uninhabitable. But then after a bit more, about 5 billion years' time, the sun will become a red giant, and its gases on its outer layers of gas will expand to engulf the Earth completely. So we won't even exist. We'll be inside the sun.
Yeah.
The Earth will still be there probably orbiting, but it'll just be in the sun.
Yeah.
It's just quite warm. Cool. Don't worry about global warming, guys. It's going to get much worse.
It's too late. So what would happen to... So there are supermassive black holes in the center of each galaxy.
Yeah, we're talking about the stars missing each other. We're
yeah,
talking about
yeah.
the gas clouds colliding and creating new stars. What's going to happen? Because, correct me if I'm wrong, but we have a supermassive black hole at the center of the Milky Way, I'm assuming mm-hmm. in the center of Andromeda as well.
Yeah.
What's going to happen there? Orbiting or?
Yeah, so the black holes have a lot of mass, about 4 million times the mass of our sun
mm.
in the case of our black hole.
Yeah.
And Andromeda, it's a bit bigger. So these black holes will eventually merge. So the gravity is so strong that the centers of the galaxies will start to get closer and closer and closer and closer and closer. The black holes will start to orbit one another.
Mm.
And in about 5 to 6 billion years' time, the black holes will combine. And that will release a spray of gravitational waves across the universe.
And some species across the universe will discover them on a detector.
Yes.
Yeah, and millions of years later.
They'll be going, quick, publish a paper.
Yeah. Oh, that's really cool.
So, while looking at researching your book, we found that one of the questions right at the beginning was... why are black holes not black, or something mm. to that effect?
This messed Hamid's mind up.
Yeah.
He's like, what?
Yeah.
What? They are black.
I'm like, I've watched so many of these documentaries, and they talk about how it traps light and it
yeah.
can't escape, and that's why it's black.
Yeah.
Is there something I'm missing?
Well, it's sort of ironic that the black holes are some of the brightest things in our universe, but it's confusing. So imagine the black hole is sucking everything in. It is. It is actually. Light can't escape black holes. Nothing can escape black holes apart from a few little particles, which is something very fancy that was kind of made up by Stephen Hawking. We think Hawking radiation
yeah.
is a little thing that creeps out of black holes, but you can't see that. So that's kind of irrelevant. But what happens around a black hole when material falls into it? It forms a kind of a waiting room of this gas that's spiraling around it. So it forms a disk of material. All the gas that's falling in gets very, very hot because it rubs together because it's in this disk. So when you rub your hands together, sound effects, they get very hot.
Mm.
And if you keep rubbing gas together in this accretion disk falling into the black hole, it gets incredibly hot, millions of degrees, and we see these huge bright signals from X-rays and gamma rays, and this material spirals off into space occasionally. So we can actually see really, really bright material just outside the black hole. Mm. So although the black hole's black, it's wearing a coat that is very bright.
Yeah.
And that is one of the most amazingly bright things in the universe.
Yeah.
We see these all over the sky, thousands, millions of them.
So whenever you see a really, really bright spot, it's...
With a radio telescope, pretty much everything you see with a radio telescope is the outsides of a galaxy which has a black hole in its center, and stuff's falling into the black hole and making that galaxy incredibly bright in radio waves.
Yeah.
So that's what we see when we look with radio telescopes.
And that's actually a really good segue, because, and we'll probably wrap it up real soon. Thanks a lot for your time. But I couldn't end the interview before we talked about the Square Kilometre Array, because I believe you had some involvement in getting that in Australia.
Yeah, that's right.
So you've just mentioned the significance of radio astronomy. Could you tell us a little bit for our audience, like, what is the Square Kilometre Array? Why is it so important? Mm. And why is Australia a great spot to have it?
Yeah, well, the Square Kilometre Array is a huge collection of little telescopes. And I'm talking 140,000 in Australia, and then a few hundred big satellite dish type telescopes in South Africa. So it's an international project. Australia, South Africa, New Zealand, Germany, UK, there's loads of countries involved.
Yeah.
Canada, all over the world. So countries are getting involved, and we want to build the world's most powerful radio telescope to understand the history of our universe through the last 14 billion years almost.
Yeah.
So we're peeling back the layers of information that we can't see at the moment because we don't have anything powerful enough.
Yeah.
And the reason why you use lots of little telescopes instead of one big one is because that one big one would have to be the size of the Earth.
Yeah.
And it's not practical. You're not going to get planning permission for a telescope
because
that
the
size.
The power of a telescope, like we've got one here, to see the end, is the diameter of the dish, right?
Absolutely, yeah. So it's how much light you can gather.
So with a Square Kilometre Array, all of these different, what do we call them, detectors?
Detectors or antennas.
It gets stitched together to basically, computationally, to basically form one massive
one big image.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So, yeah, you're kind of using a worker ants army of little telescopes to look at the same part of the sky all at once.
Yeah.
All the information goes into this computer brain, this huge supercomputer, and all that information is turned into images and spectra. So you can see the chemicals in space, you can measure temperatures in space, and you can also look at the galaxies and what they're doing at different times in history.
Yeah.
Because the further you look, the further back in time you're looking, because the speed of light allows us to look back in time. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's amazing. And this is going to collect insane amounts of data, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. So more data than the entire global internet traffic of today will be collected by the Square Kilometre Array.
Yeah.
So all the cat videos on the internet, if you combine those together, in fact, we're going to have more data than that, even more. So it's a lot of it's a lot of data. And we've got a huge supercomputing centre, but it's being upgraded now because it's not quite big enough.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
Well, I'm a fan of cat videos. It's a good way
good way to end science communication, guys.
So we should encourage everybody to go and buy your book.
Yep. When Galaxies Collide.
When Galaxies Collide.
It's pretty bright. You should see it in the shops.
Yeah. We'll put a link up as well.
Yeah, cool stuff.
It's been fascinating and a great discussion.
Yeah, so you too. Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Yeah. Cheers.
All the best.